वी आर लाइव सर। हेलो एवरीवन, वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल द वेटनरियंस फॉर जॉइनिंग दिस वेबिनार फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द ग्लोब। वी आर वेरी हैप्पी टू वेलकम यू ऑल अगेन फॉर द सेकंड पार्ट ऑफ द वेबिनार सीरीज। वी हैव पार्टिसिपेंट्स फ्रॉम ऑलमोस्ट 11 डिफरेंट कंट्रीज अपार्ट फ्रॉम इंडिया। दैट्स रियली ग्रेट टू हियर। सो दिस वेबिनार इज प्रेजेंटेड बाय नेचुरल रेमेडीज प्राइवेट लिमिटेड। आई डॉक्टर प्रकाश खांगल, प्रोडक्ट मैनेजर एट पेट नेचुरल रेमेडीज, will be the moderating person for today's session of this webinar. So to make this webinar very interactive, there are certain options available for chat, questions and polls on the screen. So if you are using a desktop or laptop, you can see this option on the right side of your screen. And if you are using mobile, then you can see this option by scrolling down at the bottom of your screen. If you want to introduce yourself or give any suggestions, then you can use chat options which is available. And if you want to ask any question, then please use the question options on the screen. You can ask your questions anytime during the webinar, and we'll be very happy to answer all the questions in the webinar at the end of the sessions. So after all these instructions, I would request Mr. Ayush Agarwal, our business head for Pet Natural Remedies, to introduce about Natural Remedies to all the participants. Over to you, Ayush.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you who are actively present today and who were actively present on the last Sunday's seminar. It was overwhelming to see all of your participation and the amount of questions and the interaction that we had. It's a great motivation for us to host more webinars with the best of the practitioners in this industry. One of the core values of Natural Remedies is being useful. And by keeping this in mind, we are proud to be associated with PPAK Bangalore to be organizing a series of webinars which will be useful into your day-to-day clinical practices. I would like to take this opportunity to elaborate a little more about Natural Remedies. Natural Remedies is one of the leading herbal animal and human healthcare company with over 50 years of experience in this industry. Our products include medicines and supplements for cattle, sheep, goat, poultry, and even aquatic life. We introduced Pet Natural Remedies a little less than a year ago. Our first of its kind of all natural and safe pet and pet friendly range of products includes medicines, supplements, grooming, and functional treats. We as an organization solely believe in harnessing nature and applying science for health and happiness. For more details, please log on to our website, www.petnaturalremedy.com. Thank you.
Thank you, Ayush. I request Dr. Azimullah, sir, the Vice President of PPAK, to please introduce a few lines about PPAK Association, sir. Sir, just a minute. Yeah. Yes, sir.
You can listen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon to everybody. My name is Dr. Azimullah, Vice President, Pet Practitioner Association of Karnataka. I welcome all the delegates for this webinar. Pet Practitioner Association of Karnataka is an esteemed organization in Bangalore for the practicing vets in Bangalore and in Karnataka. Under the leadership of Dr. Narendra, we are all heading towards. It's an organization of vets for the small animal practice. Nearly more than 300 plus veterinarians are registered in PPAK, Bangalore. In this pandemic COVID condition, it's very difficult to organize the seminars. Since for that reason, we are having webinar for the promotion of continuing education program. The last webinar regarding transfusion in dogs, blood transfusion in dogs by Dr. Bharanidharan was very successful. 1,100 people registered and 550 people attended. I hope by this seminar regarding diagnosis and management of chronic kidney diseases in dogs by our learned professor, will be more successful. And any feedback, please get back to us. We will see that it will be improved in the future. Thank you all. Welcome all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Parameshwar, sir, can you please introduce our renowned speaker, Yathiraj Sara, sir, please.
Respected teacher and today's speaker, Dr. Yathiraj sir, and program sponsors, Natural Remedies, Prakash and Ayush sir, and all my honorable members of PPAK, and especially again, once again, like last seminar, very important that though the secretary is not able to attend today's webinar due to some personal reasons, I hope we are able to see our beloved Dr. Narendra. Thank you very much for being organizing all these things. And I personally thank Dr. Yathiraj sir for finding time and sparing his precious, most precious time for this webinar, because he is being the most popular speaker and a teacher, most popular teacher. And when we look at the client point of view, most successful practitioner in the veterinary profession, that too in small animal field, of course, equally has excelled in large animal field also. So he's like a overall real guru for all of us. I am so proud on behalf of all the office bearers, including president, secretary, vice president, all other technical people, so proud to Dr. Yathiraj sir online today, to all our members who are really participating here. So Dr. Yathiraj sir, being a regional representative for the Commonwealth Veterinary Association for the last 4 years, he was dean of Veterinary College Bangalore for long 9 years, and for 18 years also he is president for Indian Bureaucratians Association, Mysore Kennel Club of Mysore Kennel Club in Karnataka, in our state, and he is patron for our own Pet Practitioner Association of Karnataka, and also he is executive member in Federation of Small Animal Practitioner Association of Karnataka, and he is a member in Society for Indian Breeds of Dogs, and he is member of Kennel Club of India. So many things like this. See, just I was mentioning to sir to explain about you. Maybe I have to take more time than this seminar itself. So much he has got. He is 65 years old, so active, and he was graduated in the year 1978 and postgraduated in 81 in medicine, and completed PhD in 93, and he was one of the most appreciated in the sense a merit among the Indian Council of Agriculture research candidates. It's so happy to learn, and he is now chief executive of the Lakeside Veterinary Hospital and Research Center, and very actively involved in practice. And meanwhile, he was also looking after Gadag as special officer before the college, during the beginning part of the college times, and also he was the director of research in KVA FSU, that is Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fisheries Sciences University, Bidar. Many things to tell about. He must have published more than 650-700 research articles. Along with that, he must have more than 22 advisor for 22 theses. He has guided more than 18 MSCs and PhDs. Like that, he has also participated in many radio programs and TV programs. I think he must have participated in national and international level about 50 programs, and in TV programs about 43, like that. So plenty to talk about it. Having been visited either as a teacher or a guide or a speaker to more than 12 countries, really much to tell about him. We are so happy. Sir, thank you very much for being here with us. Our great opportunity, I feel, for all our members. Before we conclude it, I want to thank you for spending your precious time. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. It was a really good introduction, sir. Yes. So, sir, doesn't need any introduction to anyone who is attending the webinar for sure. Yes. But still, it was a formality for us to introduce you, sir. Yes. So I like to take this opportunity to ask Yathiraj sir to please proceed with all the proceedings, sir. Please, sir.
Okay,
just a minute.
Yes.
Before I go on to the presentation, I'll take a minute. Let me thank Natural Remedies for being partners with EpiPac, and particularly Dr. Prakash and Dr. Agarwal, Mr. Ayush Agarwal, for being the main partners with EpiPac for organizing all these kind of webinars. And very thankful to Dr. K.T. Parameshwar for a wonderful introduction. And I'm thankful to the EpiPac President, Dr. Narendra, the Vice President Azimullah, Nagesh Reddy, the Secretary of the EpiPac, and all the office bearers for timely coming out in organizing these kind of webinars. I'm sure the kind of effort they put in to organize anything is highly appreciable. And all the time they are on new areas for education on this. I compliment them. And I thank all of them for having given an opportunity for me to share certain of the points on diagnosis and management of chronic kidney disease in dogs. So without much wasting of the time, again, thank the EpiPac and all the office bearers and the executive committee for this wonderful opportunity, and specifically Natural Remedies in the right time. They are with a very good association in the continuation education program. So with this kind of a brief introduction, let me get on to my presentation. Let me start with the presentation on that. I'm going to talk for about an hour, diagnosis and management of chronic kidney disease in dogs. And they have highlighted about where I work, everything. Please note my email in the future. If you need any kind of a way, probably you can share your information or talk to me later. Now, before we get on to anything in that, the veterinary profession should start from anatomy. So that's what I thought. We should make a holistic approach for anything that we talk of. When you talk of the kidney, then I think we need to know where the kidney is. Reason being, many a times it so happens. I still remember in one of the classes when we were taught on cardiology, we were talking about the conduction system. And it said conduction system happens as SA node, AV node, things like that. And when I read sometime later, the notes had said, where is the SA node? Just above the AV node. Where is the AV node? Just below the SA node. And probably it was so difficult for me to digest after my graduation to say whether it is in the heart, whether it is in the body, and probably that are the kind of notes I was carrying. So that is the reason why I said, let us look at, when we talk of kidney, where are they? This photo will tell us it is in the sublumbar area, and then you have on either side of that, then the ureter, urethra, and the urinary bladder. What I'm going to talk more is on the kidney diseases, not on the urethra or bladder or ureters. So I'm going to talk more on that. Look at this. The idea of putting this is just for my satisfaction to tell everybody that look at the kidney. It is bean-shaped, and obviously we also talk of kidney shaped, bean shaped, everything like that. And coincidentally, the map of Karnataka also gives us a look like a kidney shape. So that's why many people think and say Karnataka is the kidney of this country, and probably Karnataka is the kidney of the globe. And you can see the blood vessels there, cortex, and these. The idea of giving this is, so though you find such big vessels, but it has got a very, very poor supply. It hardly gets maybe 10 to 15% of the blood supply to the organ, not that everything it gets onto that. This is the cross section of the kidney. What we need to worry about is look at that. When you look at the whole lot of that, that nephron, what I mentioned there, is very important for us. The nephrons are the functional units of the kidney function. So when we talk of a kidney disease, whatever that happens on the capsule, cortex, medulla, etc., is different. Whereas when it is damaging a nephron, millions of them are there. When a nephron gets damaged, it's a permanent damage. So we need to really, really worry about that. Though it looks like a very small component, but you need to see that you protect every one of the nephron that you find in that kidney. That's most important for us. This is the normal kidney. Look at the blood vessel which goes into that, and maybe in the cats it will be in the abdominal cavity like that. This is a little background to see that sublumbar area, particularly between L3 to L7 and L2 to L6 like that, and you can palpate them many times on that. Now, let us get back with this introduction as to what a kidney disease is. Kidney disease is defined as the presence of functional or structural abnormality in one or both the kidneys. Many times people talk of, one kidney failure, both the kidney failure, whether one kidney has failed or both the kidneys have failed. When you talk of a functional variation, both the kidneys will have failed. If it is a structural abnormality, one could be normal, other could be functioning in a different way or may not be functioning at all. So either it is a functional anomaly or a structural abnormality, both lead to a kidney disease in this. Though I'm talking about the chronic kidney disease or chronic kidney failure or whatever you can talk of, the definition for ARF, there's nothing wrong in we knowing it, CKD and AKD, ARF and CRF. Earlier people used to use ARF, acute renal failure, and chronic renal failure, CRF. Now, also called as acute kidney injury or disease, AKD, acute kidney disease, and CKD, chronic kidney disease. So, in the acute renal failure is defined as an abrupt decrease in the renal function leading to retention of nitrogenous waste, whereas when we talk in terms of AKD, a continuum of renal injury from mild clinically inapparent nephron loss to severe acute renal failure would occur. And a chronic kidney damage is something like that has existed for at least 3 months with or without decreased glomerular filtration rate, that is the GFR, or a reduction in GFR by more than 50% from normal persisting for at least 3 months. That means the moment we talk of a chronic kidney disease, there has been a phenomenon of a kidney disease which has already occurred, and now that has led into the stage of a chronic kidney disease. There are situations when probably that acute phase would have been overruled, neglected, not represented, and we are into the CKD. This is the biggest difficulty for a small animal practitioner. Many a time this is how the cases are presented, and when we look at the values, which I'll talk to you a little later, that we have ended up in a chronic kidney disease. Many owners, many pet parents would say, how could this happen? Probably we have not done a test for many, many months. So he could have had the disease, and when all the symptoms have been manifested, we are looking at him as, yes, you have the kidney problem. ARF is pre-renal, intrinsic, and post-renal. Let me leave that. Now let us come back to the causes of the CKD. Causes of CKD, when we talk of it, can be congenital. This is what normally these days we see. Amyloidosis, dysplasia, this Fanconi syndrome, very common in human but less in dogs, glomerulopathy, polycystic disease. Not many cases these days. Probably even young age, like 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, with respect to the breed, not many people in Bangalore, since they've been doing an ultrasonography as a routine, and they look at the kidney, and then I've seen a couple of people sending or making a report as polycystic kidney, and obviously they are cases of CKD. And now the age of the dog is just 6 months, 8 months, 10 months, then how could it get CKD? We need to look at that. This is a congenital anomaly, and these congenital disease factors could be diagnosed by different methodologies rather than by just history and clinical signs. Acquired, when we talk of disease infections, infectious causes for a kidney disease are pretty less. Normally, one is leptospirosis, coronobacterium renal infection sometimes. Of late, what we are getting is as a sequelae of probably babesia, which could also cause, certain times Ehrlichia, which all cause infectious as a cause for a long-term disease, which lead on to CKD. Of all the lot, infectious, when we talk very specifically, it is the leptospira, which is a matter for us. Metabolic causes, anything that can lead on to hypokalemia and hypercalcemia could lead on to a kidney problem. Obstructive nephropathy, more particularly any kind of blockages, which later lead on to neoplasms. Proteinuria kidney diseases, wherein there is elimination of protein, sequelae of ARF, chronic nephrotoxin exposure, which I'll talk to you a little later, immune-mediated diseases, any kind of renal ischemia. It could be any disease process which leads on to ischemia. It could be just dehydration, hypovolemia, shock. All these can lead on to. Idiopathic is the last one which we talk of and pretty, very important for us. Pre-renal, plenty of situations like this, dehydration, hypovolemia, hypotension, decreased effective circulating volume, usually after anesthesia. This also probably many of my friends who are all sitting here in the webinar would agree with me, and they're all surgeons and anesthetists. You always say that maybe current day protocols have been like a blood test and then a surgery. If it is not done, probably anesthesia certain times, if they are into a little of their kidney insufficiency, certainly the anesthetics can make them prone for a damage and you end up in trouble. Shock, heat stroke, hypoalbuminemia, renal hypotension, that is secondary to NSAIDs and ACE inhibitors. This is pretty common these days. Not many people use stating that the dog has got pain, arthritis, DJDs, number of compounds being used for months and months together. And when you talk to them as to what is the cause of that, they would have ended up in a CKD. Need to be very, very cautious about all these. Any kind of hypoalbuminemia could lead on to this. And these kind of situations of pre-renal are invariably characterized by increased bun and creatinine concentration in conjunction with a concentrated urine-specific gravity. We need to do the urine test. Specific gravity of the urine is pretty important as the reason why we need to do this. Intrinsic renal failure may result from damage to any section of the kidney. We talked about those glomerulite, tubule, interstitium of the vessels. It could be damage to any one of this, and that can lead on to that. Most intrinsic renal failure is from tubular damage, and this is because of either ischemia or toxemia. This is what you talk of insult to the kidney. Ischemia is the blood supply. Toxemia is toxicity is being produced by majority. It could be chemical toxins, specifically to talk of probably arsenic trioxide. You can say zinc phosphate poisonings, which are very specific. Ischemias, any disease process, severity, for example, pyometra leading on to toxicities, pyometra leading on to ischemia, any kind of infectious septicemic conditions leading on to that. Bacterial pyelonephritis, leptospira, all these again cause ischemia and lead on to a renal failure. Intrinsic renal failure, the most, I would draw the attention of majority of the practitioners. Lucky that we don't use the ethylene glycol, but non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, the series of them, they all can lead on to a damage. Cholecalciferol being used by many people these days for treatment of probably as rickets, becomes a toxicity. Vitamin D3 toxicity is pretty bad. Use of aminoglycosides, not many of these compounds being used for a longer period. Lucky that majority of the small end practitioners do not use gentamicin today, but I would put a caution to everybody stating that in case you are using for some reason gentamicin, furosemide together, and if there's already an oliguric picture in them, if you combine these three together, that means to say that he's an oliguric patient and he use gentamicin and furosemide together, you would take the kidney to a near damage and the animal is nearer to the heaven as early as possible. Less common compounds which can cause are tetracyclines, cetracyclines used for a longer period. How long? Maybe sometimes weeks together. Cisplatin, amphotericin compounds being used for antifungal drugs. This can cause the kidney damage. A word of caution to a lot of the practitioners is that grapes and raisins both are contra and they have been implicated as one of the most common cause for a kidney damage. So stop using these in the adult and old age animals because they can cause enough damage to the kidney. And this is not a preferred fruit for the dogs. You need to avoid them. Now coming to the chronic renal failure is the most commonly recognized form of the kidney disease in dog and cat. This is characterized by a permanent reduction in the number of functioning nephrons. Regardless of the underlying cause, CKD may be characterized as an irreversible and slowly progressive disease. This needs to be highlighted. It is irreversible. No treatment can correct the existing irreversible kidney lesions of the CKD. Clinical and biochemical consequences of the reduced kidney function can often be managed with supportive therapy, whereas whatever the damage that has occurred, you cannot reverse it at all. This is one of the reasons why you need to be worried about a right diagnosis and a therapy. Both are very important. In dogs, acute loss of 2/3 or more functional nephrons is associated with loss of adequate urine concentrating ability. Whereas acute loss of 3/4 or more of functional nephrons results in as a team here. That means to say that more than 75% of the tissue is destroyed, then only you get into the picture of azotemia. Definition of azotemia is elevation in the nitrogenous compounds, that means both blood urea nitrogen and creatinine being elevated. Elevation of BUN, elevation of creatinine beyond the limits as we follow the IRIS is to say that 75% of the kidney has been already damaged. Azotemia is a laboratory finding with several fundamentally different causes. This should not be used as a synonym for kidney disease. It could also be seen in certain of the liver disorders, but creatinine becomes a better indicator than that, which we'll talk about a little later. Chronic in the context of CKD means an irreversible and usually progressive loss. In contrast, acute kidney injury is potentially reversible either by resolution of at least part of the kidney injury or development of adaptive compensatory enhancement of the kidney function or a combination of this. So for all practical purposes, between AKD and CKD, CKD is much more dangerous for us as compared to the AKD. There's a possibility that AKDs can be reversed and over a period they can become CKDs. GFR is accepted as the best overall measure of kidney function in health and disease. Serum creatinine remains the most commonly used estimate of GFR in dogs, cats, and humans. So everybody uses creatinine. That means to say if you're relying totally on creatinine, you have identified a kidney damage or a kidney disease when more than 75% has been damaged already. So what to do next? Let me come to that a little later. That's the reason why we also should take into consideration, instead of creatinine alone, why not talk about the specific gravity of the urine? This is equally important. And the specific gravity of the urine can be easily recorded, which I'll show you in the due course of time. A general word, not much to talk about pathogenesis. Studies indicate that the rate of disease progression correlates with the amount of proteinuria, and the therapy designed to reduce proteinuria retards progression. So the elimination of protein in the urine is a very good guide for us. As long as there is no protein in the urine, obviously you can see that we are toward the recovery or on the maintenance. Similarly, generalized progressive interstitial disease initially caused by the bacteria eventually destroys the tubules and the glomeruli and stimulates inflammation and fibrosis. The moment the fibrosis occurs, the excretory function of the kidney is jeopardized. Hence, it becomes very difficult for us to manage. Regardless of the initiating cause, replacement of the majority of the damaged nephrons would occur with the collagenous connective tissue, which results in the overall reduction in the kidney size and impairs the kidney function. So whatever you talk of a nephron is now replaced by the collagenous connective tissue, which is a non-excretory portion it becomes. With this in background, let us look at the methods of diagnosis that we have for renal disorders. Number one, methods of diagnosis, history, physical examination. When you do this, a thorough history and a good physical examination is necessary. When you do this physical examination, you can look at the oral cavities, which I'll show you again. Once again, I'll come back. Now, when you do this, physical examination can do that. And history, look at the posture of these animals, what I put it in the feline group versus the dog. And this is the typically rubber jaw, what is normally seen in hyperphosphatemias. Soft bone would occur into that. And this is a good indication for that. Laboratory evaluations, renal function tests, radiography, renal biopsy. We'll go ahead like this. What are the options that we have and what is that we can do? Apart from these, exploratory laparotomy, quantitation of urinary enzymes, endoscopy, scintigraphy, CT scan, MRI, cystometrogram, and urinodynamic studies. These all become the methods of diagnosis. Now, looking at each of these, for example, you are looking at an MRI equipment there. Similarly, I can show you some more. This is the ultrasonography machine, and on the right is a scintigraph. Now, this is not necessary for everybody. But if you are looking at this ultrasound scanning, now look at this. Pale, shrunken, firm kidney with pitted surface, which can be visualized on an ultrasound. And similarly, you can look at the scarring of these tissues, and that will all be appearing on the ultrasound, and it becomes a guide for us. Now, looking at the clinical sign, this is the manifestation. What is that? Majority of the CKD cases could be presented as polyuria and polydipsia. This is the earliest symptoms. And majority of the time, what you find the case being presented is a GIT manifestation. CKD is manifested by many ways. These GIT symptoms include anorexia, nausea, vomiting, oral ulcerations and stomatitis, necrosis of the margins of the tongue, halitosis, diarrhea, melena, hematochezia. All these look like gastroenteritis. But the moment you get into this in an adult dog or a old dog, I think one has to suspect CKD rather than calling it as just gastroenteritis. The major other group, what is necessary is weight loss. Any kind of weight loss, muscle wasting, hypothermia, lethargy, weakness, muscle tremors. Not many animals show hindquarter tremors. Uremic pericarditis, pneumonitis, hypertension, altered behavior, renal osteodystrophy, and a hemorrhagic diathesis. These are all seen in CKD. So it is not one system that is involved in the CKD. So it is a GI, it's the overall, and circulatory system, where CKD is the most common cause for elevated blood pressure. Organ systems most commonly affected by the elevated blood pressure include eyes, kidney, nervous system, and cardiovascular system. You do find changes in all these, apart from the renal system itself. So you need to look at all these and then suspect a CKD. Look at this, oral ulcers. You can see the bleeding point, a big ulcer being formed there. These are called the uremic ulcers. And you could also see the halitosis. The moment you have the halitosis in an animal, you should start suspecting that there's a possibility of a CKD without even asking for more symptoms than that. Very important unto that. Look at them. The arrow marks all show ulcers. When you open the oral cavity, you can find all these oral ulcers. And these are different from the B complex or the B12 deficiency ulcerations, which we'll see many a times in young Spitz and Pomeranians, which are primarily on vegetarian diet. These are different than that. And you can see, look at this kind of saliva, blood-tinged saliva, discharge coming out of these animals is very unique. This is the rubber jaw, what we talk of many a time. Sometimes you find them and their head and other things being totally positioned in a different way, very soft structure of them. And this is because of alteration in the calcium levels. Even the x-rays would show that. What is going to ultrasonography when you look at that? Starting from this, if you look at the normal kidney, intrinsic injury of a dysfunction, when there's a structural damage and an altered function, there's a kidney failure. What you talk of recovery is CKD stage 1, CKD stage 2 to 4, and this is what is happening in the kidney, and this can be visualized by the ultrasonography in different ways of that. So that becomes a good tool for the diagnosis, at least for assessing the prognosis. Laboratory evaluation, elevated BUN and creatinine. I'll talk to you about the normal values and the cutoff values. Hyperphosphatemia, metabolic acidosis, hypocalcemia, hypo or hyperkalemia, anemia. These are very, very standard, probably, findings in cases of CKD. Cutoff values have been changing. Blood urea nitrogen, people take anything from 20 to 40 as normal. Then what would be 50, 60, 70 like that? 90 and above values are considered as renal. Less than that are considered as pre-renal. Creatinine, I'll talk to you the classification based on iris classification. Now it has almost come to the stage of an adult animal where the cutoff value becomes 1.4, not like 1 to 2. Which we normally used to talk earlier. Phosphorus level. Similarly, I'll show you the normal values of these. When we look at that, you will. Similarly, urine analysis. Rarely people talk of urine analysis. Maybe it's just simple reason being that you need to catch the urine as the animal is voiding or pass a catheter. You need to do a bladder puncture or a cystocentesis. Do this. And this can be done by a TS meter, a total solids meter. And it should be in the range of, you can make out what I've given you, the range there is 1014 to 1035. And if you find this proteinuria, glucosuria, CAS, take 15 ml of urine, centrifuge it, and examine the sediment under the low power of the microscope, and you'll find RBCs, WBCs, bacteria, crystals, particularly calcium crystals. Urine culture, whenever it is necessary, becomes a tool, diagnostic tool, Ivan. These are different kinds of WBCs, renal CAS, and you could also see the calcium oxalate crystals. These are helpful for both ways of diagnosis as well as for the management. But also you can dissolve them suitably, altering the pH of the urine so that the further damages do not occur in that. Calcium oxalate dihydrate, scanning electron microscopes show these kind of crystals, which you will see under the low power of the microscope one. Sulfur drugs, particularly when they are put onto, you will find crystals and the sediments like this, needle-shaped crystals of them. Metabolic acidosis, hyperphosphatemia, they become very, very important for us. The initiating cause cannot be identified at the time of diagnosis of CKD in the majority of the patient. I would like to stress upon this point because as a practitioner, a lot many people face this kind of a problem because the owner asks, what is the cause of the CKD? You got it done, creatinine, and you say CKD. What is the cause? Very difficult to identify at this point of time. Biopsies are indicated when results are likely to substantially influence prognosis or treatment. More particularly, these are done in many situations like probably glomerular nephritis, which are immune mediated, where you can go in for a biopsy. But as a routine in animal practice, people do not go in for a renal biopsy as a routine methodology. Looking at this hematological value, this is a standard methodology. That's why I copied for all the animals. But you look at these. What is more important here for us is the hematological picture, which are not very much varying except for the anemia to talk about. When you look at TEC, hemoglobin, these are important for us. Situations wherein hemoglobin can go less than 8, sometimes even less than 6, quarantining in a severe way. This is obviously because of in CKD, the factor that is responsible for these are secondary anemias. Erythropoietin gets secreted from the kidney. When there's a kidney damage, erythropoietin is affected. And erythropoietin being affected, and there is secondary anemia, which needs a specific medication. Looking at the biochemical values of these, all I put it in the red. What you need to worry about them are these. Bicarbonates, calcium 8.6 to 11.2, creatinine 0.5 to 1.5. I would now say 1.4 because IRIS, that is the International Renal Interest Society, has modified it to 1.4 in the adult animals. Phosphorus 2.2 to 5.5, potassium 3.7 to 5.8, these are important for us. Sodium 141 to 153, and blood urea nitrogen normally 12 to 25. These are the normals for us, and these are very important, not from the point of making a precise diagnosis, but they're very important for the management and also to assess the cases and also to talk about the prognosis about a case and to bring about alterations in them. When I look at these certain times, when I said hyperkalemia, when you talk of, just look at that, we suspect it to be a case of a kidney involvement and there is a hyperkalemia, then quickly what you can talk about is do an ECG because the biochemistry may take a little longer time. If you do an ECG, if there is hyperkalemia, and look at these ECG, what you find here, all these are, this is a P wave, QRST wave, and this is correspondingly, this is a diagram, pictorial, whereas this is a recording here, you can see a P wave, QRST wave like that. Now, look at this ECG, and in this, the second one is the lead two, and you don't find one P wave there, all are QRST. QRST, QRST, and absence of P wave is an indicator of elevated levels of potassium, which is hyperkalemia. Similarly, certain times you also find hypocalcemia in this And you can see here the QT interval. The QT interval is more than 0.48 seconds in this case. And these become indicators. Why I'm talking about this point is ECG is not a primary method of diagnosis, but they're helpful in assessing the electrolyte imbalance that can occur or arise in CKD. Imaging techniques, radiographs may be demonstrate normal or enlarged kidneys, nephrolysts, ureterolysts, abdominal ultrasound may show normal or enlarged kidneys, which we all know very well, but they are only aid to a diagnosis, particularly ultrasonography. But radiography would be very important in cases of nephrolysts and ureterolysts as well. Renal sampling, especially for biopsy, when you want to talk in terms of specifically, people say that leptospirosis can be diagnosed based on a renal biopsy as well as based on ultrasound. At the corticomedullary junction, there will be a white band because the organisms are bound to be there because there is poor circulation in that, and you find a band at the renocortical junction. So people talk of, you can do ultrasound as well as you can do a biopsy in that area. These are the different kinds of biopsy needles available. These are the core biopsy, through cut biopsy, wherein you insert there and then get onto that and then take that tissue. And these are definitely useful when you say that owner is very particular, want to come up to a precise way of saying what it is, then you can go in for such. What is more important here is, look at this. When you do this, we know the position, we know how the kidney is placed, and you should look at how to place the needle into the corticomedullary junctions and that. In the incorrect method, it's straight away going into the blood vessel, it can lead on to hemorrhage. And if you are doing it by the top here and to the left way, this is the correct method. You can do it from the top as well as from the sides of that and take the sample and send it for this. And this is very specifically useful in interstitial nephritis. Others like exploratory laparotomy, CT scan, MRI, excretory urography, measurement of GFR, I think all these are more theoretical rather than practical for the practitioners. But the point here is, I just wanted to say that these are all the options that you have. Now let us come back onto the newer strategies. What is the newer strategy that we have? People said creatinine is the best, but underline that red statement, what I put it there, creatinine, an insensitive marker for mild renal dysfunction. It cannot. So the moment we talk of elevated level, it is not the mild way. It is a very bad damage that we are talking about. Then what else we can do? There are many other parameters. It's not bun and creatinine alone. Cystatin C, this correlates very well with the glomerular filtration rate, better than the serum creatinine. And this will rise before creatinine in early renal disease. Cystatin C gets elevated even at around, say, 30 to 40% damage, unlike 75% damage for creatinine and BUN. The new strategy is what you talk of is the urine biomarkers. Plenty of urine biomarkers have come, which I'll just make a mention. I'll not take a lot of time on that. Of all these, the most important, which is very useful today, is SDMA. Symmetric dimethyl arginine quantitation, SDMA. And this is very important. I'll come to that a little more elaborately. The ideal biomarkers for kidney injury are kidney specific. They are able to detect kidney injury early in the course of the disease, able to isolate the cause of the kidney injury. It could be from the renal tubule, interstitium, vasculature, etc., etc. And they say it is inexpensive, but you know very well how expensive they are. These are the novel biomarkers for acute and chronic diseases. For acute disease, a list of them. But let me come back onto the chronic, wherein you can talk in terms of the beta trace protein, NGAL, that is the neutrophil gelatinase associated lipocalin, KIM-1, that is the kidney injury molecule, and then the L-FABP, which is the liver type fatty acid binding protein. Not procedures are available for us into the market. Asymmetric dimethyl arginine was one of them earlier, but we are into the already advanced way, which is the symmetric dimethyl arginine, which is very important and pretty useful for everybody. Kidney functions could be by cystatin C, the same thing I'm talking about in different ways of that. Let me quickly go through. Cystatin C is good enough, but this is an LA AGID kit, and all of them cannot get this. And you need an ELISA read, ELISA test. And many a times you need to run many samples for these, but majority of the commercial laboratories do not have this. I had a good experience with this because one of my students worked for a thesis on this statin C quantitation, and these are very good. They can detect very early. The normal values are 0.5 to 1.5 mg per deciliter in serum of normal dogs, and it will be higher than that is considered as kidney damage. If it can detect at 40%, definitely it's very good on that. But only thing is, commercially, this is not available for us. The normal biomarkers are others, particularly for nephrotoxicities, are NAG, GSD, GGT. All these are done in the urine. This can be done by routinely, but only thing is interpretation and calculations are very important for this. Bun and creatinine level rise when 75% of the tissue is damaged. Urine enzyme levels, particularly LDH, NAG, and AP, usually rise by day 7 as compared to day 10 for creatinine and 14. So maybe when the damage has occurred, your last 14 days or 10 days in creatinine and bun, if you are talking about urine enzymes, you would have lost 7 days on that. Urine enzymes, plenty of them are available. I don't want you to get into a lot of theory, but those who are interested, please talk to me later. These are all procedures available, and you don't have the kits available, you need to get them quantitated. These are the normal values, non-azotemic and azotemic values for them, and titration goes on. Another parameter that you need to talk about is the proteinuria. This can be done routinely. What you talk of albumin test is one, and the other category is microalbuminuria. This is the urine albumin concentration, 1 to 30 mg. Severity may be assessed by measuring a 24-hour urine output, and normally you can do this. You can correlate with the urine protein versus urine creatinine, and that is a very good ratio for a quick assessment. And a simpler procedure doesn't involve too much of an expenditure on that. What you need to get that done is the urine protein and urine creatinine, and ratios need to be worked out, and I'll talk to you about the cutoffs and things like that. This is one of these total solid meters which can be used for the total protein in the urine samples as well as for the specific gravity. SDMA. Now let me come to a little more point on the SDMA. SDMA levels get elevated, anything between 10 to 20%, maximum 30% kidney damage. That means you have enough time to repair the kidney, and probably it is much better than that. Cost-wise, generally it is considered as inexpensive, but what is expensive, what is inexpensive has to be probably demarcated. Spending 2,000 to 3,000 rupees on a dog, which is probably a valued animal, is not an expensive procedure, but if it is going on a weekly basis and a day-to-day basis, might be expensive. But the point to be considered here is, for a precise diagnosis, I would say the spending the money on SDMA is worthwhile, because you can improve the quality of life of the animal, number one. You can improve the longevity of the animal, and obviously the pet parents become very happy when the animals live longer. Staging of the CKD based on SDMA. What is being considered is like this. If you are looking at the dog, stage one, normal is up to 14, and for puppies it's up to 15, but when it's come to staging, it is, you talk in terms of less than 18 microgram, that is. Stage two is 18 to 35, stage three is 36 to 54, and stage four is more than 54, and a better indicator as compared to all other parameters. This is the urine protein to creatinine ratio. You talk in terms of dogs and cats, less than 0.2 non-proteinuric, 0.2 to 0.5 borderline, and more than 0.5 is definitely proteinuric, and it definitely talks of CKD, and these parameters can be used by any practitioner to say that I am precisely making a diagnosis of CKD. Blood pressure, to people who are well versed with this and recording, and again, blood pressure is a good indicator, and it can be managed. You need to manage them because there is hypertension, renal hypertension, or a systemic hypertension. Now, what we are talking here is a systolic pressure, obviously systemic blood pressure being recorded. Less than 150 millimeters of mercury, normotensive, 150 to 159, borderline, 160 to 179, hypertensive, more than 180, severely hypertensive. Any amount of medication, when such blood pressures are there, without a specific medication to reduce the blood pressure, therapy will not be completed at all.
This is the Irish staging, what you talk of, based on creatinine value. Stage 1, less than 1.4, 1.4 to 2 is considered the second stage, and 3 is 2.1 to 5, and more than 5 is considered as the fourth stage. And I'm sure many of the practitioners listening to my talk will agree with me that you will have seen values probably 10, 12, 15, 20. I've seen a rare case of 34 creatinine, and that animal was alive. How it was alive, I don't know. And the blood urea nitrogen in that dog was something around 340. And now the question here is, will they respond? How do we do that? So anything above 5 is definitely the fourth stage, and you should keep your fingers crossed in such cases of management of CKDs. With these methods of diagnosis, now let us come back onto the treatment part of that. What is the general rule? Treatment involves limiting further renal damage and enhancing cellular recovery. When I say limiting further renal damage, assess in the history as to what has been the internal factors for ischemia and toxemia. If there are any kind of medication of all these drugs that we talked about, take it out, number one, first and the foremost. The second thing is, anything of an infectious cause, treat them specifically. That's most important. Then treatment is most successful during the induction and extension phases, and success diminishes once the later phases have been reached, more particularly onto the extension phases. Treatment of CKD should generally include specific therapy, prevention, and treatment of complications of decreased kidney function. I think specific therapy sometimes is very difficult in CKD because you really do not know the cause. That's what we talk of. Unfortunately, a renal diagnosis amenable to specific therapy is not obtained for many patients. Treatment directed at complications of decreased kidney function is often termed conservative medical management, and that's what many attempts we do it. It consists of both ways, supportive therapy and symptomatic therapy designed to correct deficits and excesses in fluid, electrolyte, acid base, endocrine, and nutritional balance. I draw the attention of everybody. What is the fluid of choice? A balanced polyionic solution. Lactated Langer solution is appropriate in most situations, unless it is associated with hyperkalemia, because lactated Langer would contain the potassium in it. You need to think about that. When the potassium levels are higher, then probably change over to physiological saline, and you can treat hyperkalemia with saline in such situations. Otherwise, the choice can be a Langer solution rather than many people using dextrose saline. You're adding a lot of sodium into that, and later leads on to edema and much more complications. Fluids low in sodium are more appropriate after rehydration, and determine the volume to be administered. This is of a great value. You need to consider a variety of factors for this. The volume for rehydration is calculated from the formula, body weight in kg into estimated percentage of hydration is equal to fluid deficit in liters. And now start the therapy. Probably you need to think in terms of, it is what is the calculation, is 66 ml per kg per day, 10 kg, 20 kg, 30 kg, calculate for the whole day, and then probably then you should do that. If it's a 30 kg dog, 660 into 3, that is the maintenance fluid required. If there is no dehydration, you need to calculate that and give that for the whole day, then only the kidney perfusion occurs. In patients with signs consistent with chronic or recurrent dehydration, if you feel intravenous fluid therapy alone is not a choice, subcutaneous fluid therapy may be considered, and it is nothing unusual for that. And subcutaneous fluid therapy can be done underneath this. Caution is that you should take care of aseptic precautions, and so that the infections do not occur and cellulitis doesn't set in these places. Urine volume. Yet another point to be remembered is the importance of monitoring urine output and composition. Urine production in a healthy animal is 1 to 2 ml per kg per hour. So calculate body weight into 24 hours. And a decrease in the urine volume may represent an appropriate renal response to hypovolemia or a pathological change in the renal function. AKI may also result in polyuria as more than 2 ml per kg per hour. This is the kind of urine production that should occur. If that is not occurring, it indicates that filtration is not occurring properly, and it has been a situation of affection of the glomerular filtration rate. You can initiate the diuresis by vannitol as a slow IV, as a bolus, 0.25 to 1 gram per kg calculate, and all of you know very well mannitol is available as a solution. You could also use hypertonic dextrose, can be used as an osmotic diuretic. Hypertonic dextrose is 10% dextrose, 20% dextrose, 25% dextrose if mannitol is not available, and you calculate as total daily dose of 22 to 60 ml per kg of a 20% dextrose solution should cause hyperglycemia and oxuria. If you do that, if you check the urine sample and if it produces glucose positive, that means it is good. It's a kidney function test. And that means to say that when you give 20% dextrose and if there is sugar in the urine after 24 hours, the kidney is functioning better. You have a chance for the animal to recover. Loop diuretics, furosemide can increase urine flow without increasing GFR. You should use furosemide. It should not be given to patients with aminoglycoside-induced acute uremia. You should take care of this. You have the choice. You can always work out on that. An increase in the urine output should be apparent 20 to 60 minutes after an IV furosemide dose. You can use 2 to 6 milligrams per kg and check the urine again. If there is no response to high doses, you should avoid furosemide administration continuously. If a response does occur, this dose can be repeated every 6 to 8 hours. Renal replacement therapy is the treatment of choice for patients that fail to respond to medical management. What is that renal replacement therapy? These are situations where you have intractable hyperkalemia, life-threatening volume overload, persistent uremic symptoms are the indicators for renal replacement therapy. Peritoneal dialysis is rarely used for critically ill people, but it is more readily available for animals than hemodialysis or hemofiltration. But all of us know the advantages and disadvantages of peritoneal dialysis. Continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis, that means doing dialysis at every 3 hours or 2 to 3 hours interval in a day, that means for 24 hours, about 6 dialysis, the values will come down, creatinine in values will come down by 1 milligram. Blood urea nitrogen may be maximum by 10 to 15 milligram. Becomes a very cumbersome procedure. Renal replacement therapy could be by extracorporeal renal replacement therapy, which includes intermittent hemodialysis and continuous renal replacement therapy. This removes uremic toxins from the bloodstream by diffusion and or convection. And for this, both you can follow, you can use the catheters, and these catheters, many are available. The human catheters are used. You also need to inject heparin repeatedly. So you need to take care of the situation of anemia when you're treating. And these are the machines available, and quite a number of people of late have started using hemodialysis. Again, not as a routine, but more useful in acute rather than chronic. But if there are toxicities, it does help even in CKD. Complications. What are the complications of this? Dextrose, 1 to 2 gram per unit insulin as an IV bolus, then 1 to 2 gram. This is necessary to prevent hypoglycemia when insulin is administered. Why do we need that? We want it to penetrate into the potassium. Correction of metabolic acidosis with bicarbonate allows an intracellular shift. You get bicarbonate for patients. Metabolic acidosis has to be treated, otherwise the animals will die. Sodium bicarbonate therapy is usually reserved for animals with a pH less than 7.2 blood pH. You could also use the oral alkalinity agents. You get quite a number of preparations for this. You can use potassium citrate, 40 to 75 milligram per kg orally every 12 hours. Simultaneously address metabolic acidosis and hypokalemia. You could also use sodium bicarbonate, 8 to 12 milligram per kg per orally. These are all available as sodium bicarbonate is available as a chemical. Potassium citrate is available as a commercial preparation. You get many preparations of potassium citrate, calculate the dosage and use them. And this is very useful for metabolic acidosis. Hyperphosphatemia is one of the big concerns for us. This can occur in both ARF and KCRF. There are no specific treatment to decrease serum phosphorus in acute stages of failure other than renal replacement therapy. Oral phosphate binders can be added when enteral feeding is started. If there is no enteral feeding, then there is no point in talking about oral administration, because the animal has continuously vomiting, ileus and nausea, then becomes very difficult unto that. Aluminium hydroxide or aluminium carbonate are administered, very ideal. These are lot many compounds are available, 30 to 90 milligram per kg per day, divided with meals twice or thrice in each of them. You can administer this. Calcium acetate can be used, 60 to 90 mg per kg. Similarly, calcium carbonate can be used, but when you use the calcium, you need to be careful about it. Certain times hypercalcemia can occur. Calcium carbonate combined with chitosan, there are many products which have come which bind to the phosphorus. This chitosan is supposed to bind to the phosphorus much better or in a good way when you combine with the calcium carbonate, and it reduces the phosphorus level. Hypertension, common complication, a word little more about is when we talk about this calcium carbonate, it is in order to avoid hypercalcemia in the European and as well as in the Western country, you have another compound called as the lanthanum carbonate, which is much better than aluminium and calcium carbonate. Hypertension is one of the most common that we talk of, and what are the choices that you have? When you say amlodipine is one of the drug to be used, 0.18 to 0.3 milligram per kg PO SID, and 0.2 to 0.4 mg for dogs. If immediate control of hypertension is necessary, hydralazine can be used, and the dose is in case of dogs is 0.5 to 3 mg per kg BID. You can use in case of dogs. You could also use ACE inhibitors, but between the ACE inhibitors and benazepril compounds, benazepril is a much better compound because it is potassium sparing, and you can use at 0.25 to 0.5 mg per kg every 12 to 24 hours. And amlodipine is used at the dosage of 0.1 to 0.2 once daily, and as needed, dosage may be increased up to 0.6 mg per kg daily. You might ask me, should we do all these in the CKD cases? The chances of recovery and the complications that you are facing and the success rate, if you want to improve, I'm sure if these are all done, the success rate will be much better. Lots of GI complications, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, most common when you talk. Even when the blood urea and nitrogen levels get elevated, it triggers the chemoreceptor trigger zone in the stomach, and there's always vomiting and nausea. What are the compounds that you can use? Antiemetics are necessary. Gastric protectants are necessary. And what are these? You can use the antiemetics as well as the sucralfate, which is a protectant. This is the common famotidine, ranitidine, omeprazole, pantoprazole, metoclopropamide. Still, it's pretty good, metoclopropamide, sucralfate. You get plenty of all these preparations. These are good. And the dosages have been mentioned to you. I'm sure you'll follow the notes. And everyone knows about these. These are good enough after that. And if you still feel I want to go in for a better compound, if these are available, meropitant, 1 mg per kg SQ or 2 to 8 mg, these are the newer compounds which you can talk of. Meropitant is coming to the Indian market shortly, or maybe I haven't seen the product the Indian way, but I did had an access to this preparation. Then ondansetron is equally good enough. You can change over to these because these prevent this nausea and vomiting. Concurrent drug usage. Because of the drug accumulation in patients with the reduced kidney function, it's a result of renal drug clearance. Dosage adjustment should be made according to the changes in the drug clearance. These are very important points of that. We need to work out on this. Anemia is one of the biggest factors that we talk of. And we say that the hemoglobin doesn't improve, comes down, halts at sometimes 6, 7, 8, no change at all. This is seen with both acute anemia because of GI bleeding, repeated blood sampling, dilution associated with the volume overload. And when you have these, you can go in for packed RBC transfusion is preferred to the whole blood. But you know very well that in case of small annual practice, as of now, only a few places there are blood banks. So blood bank has not been a choice. So many people, many practitioners depend upon the live animal donors who are all registered, and then you go for that. And plasma apheretic units, I'm sure it's very difficult and expensive to follow it up. So we need to depend on the whole blood transfusion, and whole blood transfusion is one of the choice for that. What are the other choices that you have? Therapeutic course with this to stop the bleeding, use H2 receptor antagonists and sucralfate. These are useful for to stop the GI bleeding. And since there is a deficiency of iron as well in this, oral supplementation with ferrosulfate, 100 to 300 mg. Certain animals with iron supplementation do have more nausea, so you need to be cautious on this, but definitely helpful. Transfusion of the packed red cells or whole blood may be needed in severe anemias. So not many people do this. You have the methodologies to do bags, donor collection, and you can go in for the transfusions. Anyway, we had a good lecture on blood transfusion. I don't want to talk much about this, but you need to think about this. Indeed, if you feel that blood transfusion sometimes is a bit difficult, certainly it's not possible, you can use the erythropoietin, particularly the recombinant preparations. Plenty are available. Please don't go by the trade names. What I mentioned there, this is just from the point of availability. I just put it. I'm not an endorser of all these products, anything. And whichever is good, please use them. Erythropoietin is available in 2,000 units, 4,000 units, 8,000 units. And what is recommended is 50 to 150 units per kg subcutaneously, 3 times weekly. Maybe 3 injections are good enough. I would rather say it's very good and you have a very good response by the second or the third injection. Sometimes when you find it difficult to go in for a transfusion, I would say this is a good method and you can definitely rely on that. You could also start at 100 units per kg, 3 times weekly. And people can afford, just on the point of the cost, I'm just putting it, 2000 units, starting cost is around 600 rupees to something around 800 rupees for a 2000 unit. 4000, obviously double the cost of that. There are many companies which are manufacturing this. Darbepoietin is much better compound than the erythropoietin as such. You can use them. This is used at the rate of 0.5 to 0.8 microgram per kg subcutaneously at weekly intervals. Again, there are many preparations available and less reactions as compared to the erythropoietin preparations when you use them. Calcium and phosphorus. Because you want to avoid hyperphosphatemia, you can use the calcitriol, and this should be used at the dose range of 2 to 3 nanogram per kg every 24 hours. This is specifically for secondary hyperparathyroidism when you have high levels of phosphorus that is going on there. Many preparations are available of calcitriol. They are all available as capsules. They are available as 0.25 micrograms or 0.2 micrograms. Remember, 1000 nanogram is 1 microgram. So they're available as 0.2. So you need to work out, calculate the dosage and use once in 24 hours. You can use them, they're available as capsule. You can subdivide the volume and then give it orally, and they're definitely beneficial. Renal protectants for renal function improvements, lot many compounds of later available, lot many herbs. Rhubarb is one of the compound, and you have many preparations available from different companies, which are all herbal supplements available in different names. And I would rather say that, being a practitioner, that they have been definitely beneficial, I would say, because we have seen them being used practically, and the creatinine values stabilize over a period and definitely can be used. Similarly, nutraceuticals, particularly certain of the bacteria which have been used for improvement of the gut health, are equally good enough unto that. People talk to them as intestinal dialyzers or oral dialyzers. The fact is that normally, whenever the levels of the blood urea nitrogen is higher, when they come to the enteric circulation, they are acted upon by the routine bacteria and converted onto ammonia, which again contributes to the blood urea nitrogen. So when you use these specific nutraceutical preparations, they help in breaking down that, and similarly, they help in decreasing the levels of them, and they all support you, I would say, an alternate treatment or a complementary treatment, and totally cannot depend only on that. It should be a supportive treatment. That's why these are called protectants. And I'm sure, as I said earlier, when the nephron has been damaged, what is that role that we can make out is to improve the function of each of the nephron, probably can be achieved by these supplements and nutraceuticals. Diet, important factor, reduced protein, phosphorus and sodium content. However, not enough protein in the diet can be equally detrimental, because protein malnutrition in renal failure can facilitate the occurrence of other complications or lead to an early death. So you need to provide protein, not that protein should be totally avoided, but think about what kind of protein to be given. animal origin, less high biological value, yes, or change over to the dietary things, maybe commercial diet, which have a better balanced way, yes, obviously. Increase the B vitamin content, caloric density, and soluble fiber. A neutral effect on the acid-base balance. Supplementation of omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids, because these reduce the inflammatory process that are occurring in the tubules. Further damages can be prevented. Addition of antioxidants will also help in minimizing the further damage that can occur in the kidney. Now, the next question arises is whether commercial renal diet versus the homemade diets, good or bad, should we change, should we not change, which is better, which is not better, what is good, what is not good, can they afford, all are the same, definitely highly debatable things, but give a serious thought to that. Again, whether it should be dry food or a semi-solid food, it all depends, animal likes, doesn't like, whether I can go in for a liquid diet and talk of internal feeding, enteral feeding, wherein you have patients being hospitalized, you can go in for the tubing and then start feeding it, or there are again in the enteral feeding, you have the oral route, you can also go in for esophagotomy and put the tubings, you can make gastroplank, so many other procedures are available, and these are all really good enough. And if you have to change, I think there's a necessity of all these changes. Sorry. Take home, to conclude all these, what I would say is CKD is one of the most common form of kidney disease in dogs and cats, and early detection is very important. Early detection is very, very important. Amongst the biomarkers, SDMA is very promising. People should rely upon SDMA, I'm sure. This is very good onto that. And you should be happy that these kind of procedures are available in India now. Regardless of the underlying cause, CKD may be characterized as an irreversible and slowly progressive disease. No treatment can correct existing irreversible kidney lesion or CKD. Clinical and biochemical consequences of reduced kidney function can often be managed with supportive therapy. Nutritional management has to be given due importance, and that would probably improve the life of the animal, the quality of life, and also the longevity of the animal. Thank you very much for all of you for sparing your time and patiently listening to the presentation. Thank you very much. Again, thank all the organizers for giving your time for me, and all the listeners for this kind of talk.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really a great pleasure to listen to you. Like we have a lot of comments in the chat section, like people are finding it really, really interesting and good insights in this presentation.
Yes, yes.
Sir, so like after this, like we'd like to proceed to a question answer section.
Yes.
So would you like me to read the questions, or like there is question section, you can also
I'll come back to that itself straight away. Can I come back there? I can minimize this and come back to that. Can I do that? Or I need to open the, I can come back there straight away. One second, I'll come back to the.
You can come to browser.
Yeah, I can come back to the chat. I can come back.
Next to the chat, there is a question section, sir.
Yeah, I'll go to the question section.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So in that, sir, you just click on the date option available in like just a question, small date you can see. Click on the date, you will get the first question asked then.
It's loading the question. How to manage CKD with commercially available renal diet or homemade diet? The question here is, what is more important is the level of the protein and the kind of protein to be fed. If you can manage, with the protein of high biological value, and you need to work out a combination for this in the homemade diet. Obviously, people would think in turn for a commercial diet because it's already been formulated. If you want to do it a homemade diet, yes, it is possible. You can very well do it. Any role in metabolism in high urea? Normally, it is said that anabolic steroids are not a good tool, though it was being used in the early days, and that I think may not be very important these days to use these, because if there's hyperproteinemia, there is muscle wasting, any anabolic steroid will further bring about catabolism and the protein levels will go down. And proteins are pretty, pretty important. Relationship between poor quality of commercial feed with the CKD. Yes, obviously, if the quality of the food is not good, I'm sure there's no point in going for that. Upon diagnosing kidney damage, confirmation infection due to field condition, would choose antibiotic if necessary. Normally, you can say that more than 90% of CKD is not associated with infection, but for Leptospira or as a sequelae of Babesia, Ehrlichia, what you've been talking about. So in such situations, please go ahead to the antibiotics. And rest of the time, for a kidney disease, for a CKD, antibiotic is not of a concern, to tell you frankly. Suggest some homemade products. You talk in terms of the homemade products in the sense you need to work out the carbohydrate, protein, and fat as a maintenance ration and put onto that. That will be idea. Any particular reason why the P wave is absent in hyperkalemia? Yeah, wonderful question. It is said hyperkalemia, if you say why, I don't know, hyperkalemia produces absence of P wave. That's what I can say. But for the absence of the P wave, generally, it could also be a situation of pacemaker, what we talk of. Talk of atrial standstill. P wave is associated with atria. If you find a normal potassium level and absence of P wave, it is a cardiac problem. If it is high potassium and absence of P wave, it is hyperkalemia, and that hyperkalemia because of so many reasons, and one of the reason is hyperkalemia associated with renal failure.
So if we go down, there are
I should go down for the questions. Yes, okay, right.
Yes, sir. Yes, scroll it down.
Okay, same question. Relation between poor quality commercial feed with the CKD. Yes, see what will happen with the poor quality of disease. As I said earlier, there is already the animal is going down in condition, and if you don't give a good quality or a good amount of protein as required, the further protein level will not be available at all. Animal goes down in condition. How to manage CKD with commercially available renal diet or a homemade diet? I, for one, I would say go by stating that I am not for anybody as a prompt or anything. There is science in a commercial diet. If you can put that science into preparing a diet at home, you can do as well. There's nothing wrong in it. What is important here is how much time you have to prepare a diet. Whether you can balance the diet is important. If you can balance the diet, definitely you can prepare your diet by homemade methods, or else go in for the commercial diet. I would put it that way, because commercial diet become more palatable. Reason being, homemade diets, to make them more palatable by routine method is very difficult. The palatability of the diet is improved by addition of fat in the diet. So by increasing the fat in the diet, you are creating an imbalance, and that can further be harmful to the organ that you are aiming at.
Yes.
Decabolin, people did talk about it. Diet for renal patients, yes, same questions. Normal diet that can be advised to owner in case of CKD, yes. Say that avoid proteins which are easily broken down, number one. It is said the requirement of the protein, keep it at 14 to 16%. Use a high biological value. High biological value protein is the egg. That's one to talk of. You can talk in terms of the albumin, and rest of the things can be avoided. And balance the ration based on whether it's a 10 kg dog or a 20 kg dog or a 30 kg dog. Calculate the calories based on the requirement. The normal requirement is between 70 to 80 kilocalories per kg per day. Derive that from carbohydrate, protein, and fat. Derived to the extent of 50% by the carbohydrate, 30% by fat, and 20% by the protein. So you calculate in that ratio and work out depending on what the dog can eat. You might formulate a diet, but you might say give enough of dal as a protein. The dog will end up in flatulence, so it may not eat that at all. So the question here is what the dog likes is equally important. So you cannot just prepare a diet and say this has protein, fat, and carbohydrate and give to the dog, because it also matters as palatability of that. So you need to work out what is good for the dog, and also monitor the weight of the dog, monitor the creatinine value, whether it is increasing, decreasing, what is happening to the potassium value, phosphorus value, whether you're adding them or not. All these become important when you are talking about the homemade diet.
Yes, sir. Next is like, should we go for urine alkalizer in CKD dogs?
Yes.
Which ones?
The question here is, you get, see the SH, what is the level of this? We talked about acidosis. See, the acidosis, what we talked about, the pH is of the blood, what we talked about. You check the urine pH as well. As such, in case of dog, the pH will be ranging anything between 5.5 to 6.5. If it is less than 5, then definitely you can say it's acidic and go in for alkalinizers. Potassium citrate is an alkalinizer. Sodium bicarbonate is an alkalinizer. So you can use soda bicarb orally and treat them. You can very well do that. It's an alkaline reservoir.
Yes, sir. So the next question is like, does there is any relationship between dehydration related to bilateral polycystic kidney?
It does. The reason is what will happen in these situations is in the polycystic kidney, rather than the theory I put it, because I've seen in these last 2 years, at least about half a dozen cases diagnosed by my colleagues in Bangalore. They have put it back to us many a times. And if the animal doesn't take food, obviously dehydration would occur. The question here is the polycystic kidney elimination of them is equally important. And invariably they end up in dehydration repeatedly. Though they survive, but their weight gain is very, very poor. And the skin is always in a different way. Coat is dry. And you need to, and probably hematology would help in assessing the dehydration based on PCV values. They are more important for us to assess the dehydration, and accordingly, treatment can be chalked out.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So the next question is like, what is the relation between anemia and CKD?
This is what I said earlier. It can be the cause of anemia could be two. Number one, blood loss. Blood loss in terms of ulcers, what it is causing, what you said, GI bleeding. It can be from the stomach. Many a times people report saying that the emotion is black in color, melena. Where is this melena occurring? Melena is occurring because of there is bleeding in intestine. That's one. The second thing being, kidney produces the enzyme or the hormone you can talk about, the erythropoietin. The erythropoietin production is from the kidney. Since there is a damage in the nephron, erythropoietin production is decreased. So there is no stimulus for the bone marrow. This is the second. The third thought people talk of but not scientifically proven is elevated levels of blood urea nitrogen also suppresses the bone marrow is one of the thought, not always. So all these contribute to the anemia. That is the reason why we need to stimulate the bone marrow. So when you're giving erythropoietin in the form of probably erythropoietin recombinant and darbepoietin, these are bone marrow stimulants. People might ask me a question, can I use a hydrocortisone to stimulate the bone marrow here? No, not in this. Not in the kidney diseases. But because you use them in probably ehrlichia, wherein it is necessary to use a corticosteroid in two ways of that, to improve the function of the liver, to augment the functioning of the Kupffer cells by the prednisolone, it does work. It also helps low doses to improve the bone functioning or the bone marrow functioning when you use in the prednisolone. They are particularly for treatment of anemia in ehrlichiosis, but not for treatment of anemia in kidney disorders. Corticosteroids would worsen the situation for that because the water retention will be more, sodium retention will be more, so the further damages will not occur.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, how do we calculate? Yet another question is, how do we calculate renal drug clearance? Really, you'll have to work out. These are typically possible in a research institution, and you can work out on that. There are formula, and you need to quantitate the drug that you are using, calculate the urine output for 24 hours, and then work on that. Why proteinuria in the CKD? Yeah, this is what you talk of. What is happening here is, the nephron being affected, the filtration gets affected. So the protein gets just eliminated. Protein has to be reabsorbed in the system. If the protein is not getting reabsorbed, the protein gets eliminated. That's why you call proteinuria. So proteinuria is occurring because there's a damage in the kidney. So damage in the kidney could have occurred by some reason. And that's why earlier people used to talk of just albuminuria. Now people talk of microalbuminuria. Microalbuminuria is helpful to the extent of around 30%, I would say.
Yes.
About 30% of the cases can be diagnosed based on microalbuminuria. Yes. I'm audible? Yeah.
Yes, sir. I think he lost. Just a moment, I'll just ask him to join again. I think he lost the connection, sir. Is coming back. So I hope everybody is able to get the answers for the questions. Anybody having further questions, please post in the question sections. We'll ensure like every question has been answered. I I'll just check, Harish. There's just a technical error, like the connection has been lost from Yathira's side. So just let me take 2 minutes or 3 minutes for him to join again.
Hello. Hello. It says refresh your page. It says there is problem with your connection. It says.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. I will read the questions for you, sir. There is some problem with his connection, Aish. Just call him again. So Yathira sir, connection is just lost, is coming back again.
Go for force connection. Force connection. One more line.
So force connection.
Yeah.
So we have enough kind of questions being asked today. Yeah, it's coming back.
Yeah, I'm able to see you. Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Yeah, you can hear me. Please comment on the Dallas part. When to? It is expensive also. See, the question here is any value above 5 in humans is considered for dialysis. The question of expensive, I don't think we need to worry about it, because here the question of prolonging the life of the animal is pretty important. And you can bring down the creatinine value definitely with one dialysis. You can bring it back to normal. And again, it will shoot up. And how frequently you have to do it. And these are all dialyzing machines. The artificial kidney can be protected and can be kept for individual dog. And in human side, now they are doing dialysis even for 500 rupees. So over a period, they will all become cheaper. Initially, they are all expensive. You have to accept. There is no other way.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So there are certain questions being asked in the chat section also. I'll just ask these questions.
Shall we go
sir,
to
the chat section? Yeah, sir. So one of the participants asking, like, can you please elaborate like again on the diagnosis part a little?
Which diagnosis?
On the entire diagnosis he has asked, sir. Like,
okay, let him probably, I think, you know, like, seem to be precise.
Yeah, he can go through the video, sir. I'll suggest he can go through the video, sir.
Yeah, he can go through the video. Or simply to put it, what we can say is, he has to depend upon biochemistry, a good history, and then quantitation of one creatinine, and now I would say SDME. That's it. If you can rely upon that, that's a good diagnosis with a clear history. Yes.
So the next question was like, how CKD develop oral ulcers and rubber jaw, sir?
Yeah. See, number one is ulcers. See, what is the function of the kidney is to eliminate the ammonia and the urea, both. Okay. Urea, more particularly. When the urea level gets elevated, once the kidney and liver is not able to handle, what happens is the epithelial tissue thinks that it can handle. So it goes into the epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue has no enzyme system to eliminate that. So it accumulates, and over a period,
it creates inflammatory reaction, and thus it ends up in an oral ulcer. That's how the ulcers end up. And during the process of inflammation, they also end up in bleeding. That's how the ulcers develop in that.
Yes, sir. And the rubber jaw, sir?
In rubber jaw, when we talked about hyperphosphatemia, there is an imbalance of calcium and phosphorus. This is what you talk in terms of secondary hyperparathyroidism, and the calcium doesn't get deposited there. So the bones becomes rubbery. Okay, that's why it's called as a rubbery jaw syndrome.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Great. So there's another question, like, can you brief about anesthesia leading to CKD?
Anesthesia leading to CKD is simply, I don't want to talk too much about that because I'm not an anesthetist nor a surgeon. But as a practitioner point of it, anytime you put the animal onto any sedation or an anesthesia, these blood supply to the kidney also gets reduced, number one. And if you are using a compound which is being eliminated by the kidney, if there is already a preliminary condition of a non-functional kidney, these anesthetics can damage the nephrons and lead on to an increase in the creatinine level. And for a long surgery, if you are doing a surgery for 4 hours and 6 hours, if you are doing that, you may be saying that I'm making a patient as ambulatory, I'm continuously giving the fluids. So maybe surgeons are there and a lot many anesthetics are there. They have a better answer than me. I'm sure if you take care of them, less complications. And simply just putting on to interval sodium and then doing a surgery, expecting the animal to recover without fluid therapy, I'm sure it will end up in a kidney failure.
Definitely, sir. Sir, another thing is, like, one person has asked, like, why we go for diuretics as already animal is having polyuria in CKD?
Yeah. The question here is, see, accumulation of these, to improve the function of the remaining tissues of that, we do not want any of these accumulation to occur. The question here is, formation of the urine is equally important. If there is already polyuria, we are not going in for treatment with that. Furosemide is indicated for oliguric patients, not anuric patients, not polyuric patients. It's not for that. Okay?
Thank you.
It's for oliguric patients. See, there's a lot of difference between anuria, oliguria, polyuria. It is not for polyuria patients. Polyuria patients are, it's functioning very well. You don't need it.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So, like, there's like question, like, sir, can we use dextran injection in restoring anemia and CKD?
Dextran is not a treatment for anemia. It is just only a fluid volume expander. It's not a treatment for anemia. No.
And, like, another question, like,
yeah.
Yes, sir. The question is another, like, can any choice of antibiotics in CKD?
No, that's what I said. See, if it is primarily of a bacterial infection, you should think of. As of today, the bacterial infection is Leptospira and Corynebacterium. Leptospira responds very well to the series of drugs. Everyone knows about it. It's starting from penicillin, all kinds of quinolones, and you can use even tetracyclines, but you should use them with caution. And Corynebacterium responds very well to amoxicillin clavulanic acid, then doxy, it can respond very well. Penicillin is not a choice there. But other things being infectious cause being, as I said earlier, Babesia, Ehrlichia, you know the choice of the drugs. You need to treat them under that. Here you're not treating as kidney disease, you're treating the primary disease there.
Yes, sir. So the another question is, like, why not LDH can be taken as a common diagnostic enzyme in case of CKD?
Yeah. The question here is, all these urinary enzymes you can definitely depend upon, and you need a combination of that. LDH, NAG, alkaline phosphatase, any of them that you do, probably GGTs also you can do it. It should be urinary enzyme quantitation and not blood serum quantitation. If you can do that, yes, they are also indicators of that. It's not that it cannot be done, but the question here is reliability of that. Reliability of that. Unless you are doing it in-house, it may be difficult because these are not kits, and you can definitely do that. There's nothing wrong in it. And of that lot, rather than the LDH, NAG is a better enzyme than that, because each of those enzymes, I did not go into the details of that, you know very well that where they get secreted is very important. It talks about that particular damage. Tubular enzymes, NAG is a tubular enzyme. So you are talking about a tubule function, do that specific enzyme. That's why there are about 10 biomarkers listed talking about each of that area. GGT, when you talk of GGT, can be used. You can do a serum GGT, you can do a urinary GGT. And then you have to get done creatinine and work out the ratio of all these and then work out on that. Then definitely you can use them. Nothing wrong in it.
Thank you, sir. So, like someone has asked, like can bladder pathology result in CKD? And yeah. Does feeding raw meat may have any effect on the condition?
The question of this is a very important question. I would put it as, what is the role of protein in the diet for a disease? There have been a lot of literature which have come, and also I've surfed through and been interacting with lots of nephrologists, veterinary nephrologists. It is said relation of diet prior to the occurrence of a disease, protein has no relation to delivery. Whether it is a low quality protein, high quality protein, high quality, best quality protein, whatever you take, that leading to kidney disease doesn't occur. It is the other complication that you'll end up as. But the question here is, once the CKD has occurred, give a good quality protein. That's most important. And changing of the protein to higher value, lower value, whether it will improve the life, is not that. Quality protein is very important. Nothing other than
that. So in that they have asked, can bladder pathology result in CKD?
This is one question. Bladder pathology can lead to, when you talk of accumulation, if there are calculi, what you talk of reverse phenomena, and that can lead on to toxicities and cause a damage specifically. But as an ascending infection, it doesn't go. It doesn't cause any disease after that. But if there are obstructions, it can lead to kidney damage. Pressure can lead to that. Okay, reverse phenomena of stasis of urine for a longer period, it will end up in kidney failure.
Okay,
it can cause many a times, you get into the polycystic condition, similar to that, you come across cysts in the kidney, which can lead on to that. Whatever the hydronephrosis can result into that, it ends up in hydronephrosis and then ends up in a kidney failure.
Okay, sir. So there's another question, high creatinine level more than 5, what is the treatment, sir?
What we now talked about, irrespective of whether it is 4, 5, 8, whatever it is, you need to go in for a rigorous treatment. Usually it is said, once you have made a diagnosis, start the medication, fluid therapy. If the animal is oliguric, diuretics, good amount of B complex, and then H2 receptor inhibitors, supplementation of whatever that you want, do the therapy with fluid 3 days, monitor the creatinine value, and if the values are coming down, then you have a hope that the animal will recover. Also supplement in this period, if the animal is not eating, you are depending totally on the fluid therapy. So whether the eternal feeding is happening or not, you need to monitor all these and work on that. All the combinations of each complication, what I said, you need to treat them. And core becomes fluid therapy and supplementation with B-complex, because there is no B-complex available by any other method. So you might say B-complex is a treatment. Yes, because there is no intake. These CKD patients don't eat for days and days together. Then where is the question of any kind of normal being there? Because none of the majority of the B-complex, you might think, it might be synthesized, but not all will get synthesized in small animals, unlike large animals. You need to
So one question is specifically regarding the case they have asked. There is a value of burn 400, creatinine is 20,
yeah.
CBC, potassium and sodium is coming normal,
yeah.
GIT signs are present, and animal is highly cachectic.
Yeah.
Prognosis of this case, is it an azotemia condition, sir, they're asking?
No, it is not. The question here is, when the creatinine has gone beyond 20, the corresponding values of burn would have gone up. The definition of azotemia is elevation of blood urea nitrogen or nitrogenous products. It combines both creatinine and blood urea nitrogen. It's a case of azotemia. The question here is whether azotemia is because of liver or it is because of kidney. Here I would say it's because of kidney, not because of liver. And such values of 400 can take the animal into hepatoencephalopathy. They end up in ammonemia and they can end up in seizures. Definitely bad case. Very, very bad case, I would put it.
Yes, sir. So the next question is, there's already protein urea and CKD, and still, as a vet, we recommend them to give good quality protein. Why, sir?
Yeah, that's what I answered that question already. That is a repetition question.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Then another, sir, can you please comment on dialysis part? We opt for it since it is an expensive also.
Yeah. See, for example, dialysis is a field which is emerging, I would say, number one. It's very good for acute renal failure, or AKI, to more specifically to talk of. In CKDs, it does help, provided you can do that at respective intervals. When I say at repeated intervals, you need to monitor the values. what is the value you want the creatine? For example, if you have a high potassium, let us say, easiest way to bring down the potassium levels will be dialysis. You can bring it back to normal quickly. So the values of these, when we talk of dialysis, you are passing the blood through an artificial kidney, which are nothing but a series of filters, and you are putting back the blood back into the system. So you have brought the value to what level is a calculation. Depending on the level of creatinine, blood urea androgen, potassium, everything, weight of the animal, volume, you calculate the dialysis time. So you dialyze a patient for 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour to bring the value back to that normal and then leave that animal for that. So the subsequent, how soon again it will take the value to higher value, you should decide on that. That depends on the diet, and you should decide how frequently you want to do the dialysis. Initially, it can be once in 3 days. Later on, it becomes once a week. In some situations, once a fortnight, once a month. That's what it happens in human. Same corollary works, because I was working with Dr. So many of them, I don't want to name the human nephrologists. Used to go regularly there. And it all depends on how you manage this kind of thing. Initially, definitely, maybe some time ago when I was talking about establishment of veterinary hospital practice, as I used to say, specific referral centers. If there's a specific dialysis center, I think it's more convenient. But when it is mixed with specialty clinics, definitely it has to be expensive, because you have to put a unit and you'll have to dedicate a person for this. And if you have to do a dialysis, it's about 5 to 6 hours time. So that 5 to 6 hours time has to be spent on a single patient. It becomes expensive. People will say in human it is 500 rupees. Yes. And in a single room, there will be 20 machines. And there will be one doctor to manage. Whereas here, my next patient is either a cardiac patient, or my next patient is a fecal sample examination patient, or it could be a deworming patient. So how do I devote 6 to 8 hours on a dialysis and say I'll make it cheaper? See, the cost is not the criteria in this.
So the next question is regarding what is the parental dose of sodium bicarbonate in case of vomiting dogs?
In the case of vomiting, the question of sodium bicarbonate, when we talk of, we are not talking in terms of the vomiting. The recommended dosage of sodium bicarbonate is 8 to 12 milligram per kg twice daily. 8 to 12 milligram per kg body weight twice daily. It is for treatment of acidosis. Similarly, you could also use potassium citrate. Potassium citrate is 40 to 70 milligram per kg twice daily. This is the dosage for treatment of metabolic acidosis. And vomiting, it doesn't control that. Whether soda bicarb you're going to inject intravenous, you do get sodium bicarbonate preparations, but you need to monitor and calculate the value and appropriately reach that. For example, what is the kind of value that I'm looking at bicarbonate? I should look at the value and get it done. You need to really calculate that.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, like, if mannitol or dextrose 25 is not bringing dialysis, then what to do? And if urine is there in the bladder, but it is not voided by the animal because of stasis of urine, what can be done in such cases?
Yeah, this, for example, if there is urine in the bladder and the animal is not urinating, the question of CKD is not the point for us here. It is the question of cystitis bar stasis of urine. The bladder, urine is there in the bladder, animal is not voiding, it can be obstruction, number one. It can be urethritis, it can be cystitis, it can be a urinary calculi. Maybe you can call it as a cystolith, or you can also call it as a urethrolith. It can be any one of the lith, more specifically urethrolith. Even urethritis, the animal doesn't pass urine. Or it can be a situation of stimulation. It could be neurological as well. There is injury. So these are totally different. Not passing urine is totally different. When we talk of animal is not farming, the urine is different. See, one of the phenomena in the pathogenesis, what I said is the normal quantity of urine should be 1 to 2 ml per kg per hour per day should be the quantum of urine the animal should pass. If that is being produced, that means the kidney is functioning normally. If that is not being done, and the condition what they are referring to is more of a bladder problem rather than a CKD problem. So in such situation, you work out on making the animal to pass urine by whatever be the methodology that you aim at, diuretics, maybe sometimes in a loop diuretics. Maybe sometimes you also use the 20% dextrose as a volume expander and then create diuresis. If it is totally neurological, different. If it is DJD and there has been a stasis of urine and defecation both, then probably you should aim towards a different phenomena.
Definitely. So thank you, sir. So like the another question is like reliability of specific gravity of urine to differentiate AKD and CKD.
Oh, very, very important. See, normally when we talk of specific gravity of the urine, you talk in terms of so many ways. Okay, you talk of isosthenuria, hyposthenuria, hyperosthenuria. Isosthenuria is a condition where you talk of the specific gravity gets fixed between 1006 to 10013, 10013. This is called isosthenuria. If it is less than that, hyposthenuria. If it is more, hyperosthenuria. Acute renal failure is always higher. Acute kidney disease, specific gravity is high. Chronic kidney disease, specific gravity is low. This is how we differentiate, and very reliable. And what you need is, you need to collect a midstream urine. This is most important. Midstream urine, either by catheterization or when the animal has voided it, put a drop into the TS meter. I would say very good on that. You don't need a urinometer, because urinometer needs minimum 30 ml of the urine, whereas the TS meter need just few drops, one or two drops. But the standard procedure for a urine analysis of interpretation is collect a minimum of 15 ml, and then interpret the results. That is the best way to do it.
Definitely, sir.
Yes.
Sir, so the another question, there are some repetitions. I will not take those questions.
Yeah.
So any commercially available kidney support supplement that we can give in animals while undergoing therapy, sir?
Oh yeah, there are many preparations available, because I didn't want to talk on them because my colleagues and my friends are all sitting. See, if I start talking about those products, it becomes an endorsement. And I'm talking at the banner of the PPAC, and I'm talking at the banner of the natural remedies. So why should I talk about those brands? They're all available. Let them find out. Correct? Am I right?
No problem.
I think I should not talk the brand of, it becomes something like, you know, like, see, if it was purely a PPAC seminar closed in-house, I would have definitely talked about it. But when we have a banner of PPAC and natural remedies, I will not talk about a different company brand name at this point of time. Many preparations
great
available. Let them find out those products and then use it.
Yes, sir.
Maybe if there are some questions,
they can definitely come back to us personally, yeah, personally on like email or WhatsApp.
Let us not use this forum for talking about a product. In fact, I have deliberately taken out all those slides, though I have the photographs of all those preparations, just to tell people that they're available. Isn't it? But when I'm on a banner of natural remedies and my banner is being parent being PPAC, I should not talk about it. Because if I talk about that, rest of the people might say, Dr. Ethira, support these products. No, I don't want that.
No problem, sir. So like how is the prognosis of CKD been like judged, sir? Like the question is there, sir.
It's there are two ways of putting this question into an answer. I would put it as being a practitioner versus a clinician or an academician. Academician part, let me leave it at that. As a practitioner, I would say, I've seen cases with creatinine being 20, 15, 8, and then coming back to less than 5, stabilizing between 3 and 5, surviving for many months. And I still have one case which I treated about a year ago, which was 12. Then it came down to 6, and it is at 6. It is not coming down less than 6, but the animal is eating, animal is passing urine. What I'm interested is the day the animal doesn't eat for a day or two, I put the dog on drip. Because we want it to be kidney to be perfused. It's on diet, it's on the supplements, what I'm talking about, irrespective of the brand. And I would say they are very helpful and they're useful. I would say that. They're pretty good.
Definitely.
And life of the animal, there are occasions when I've seen, there are situations where the lifespan has been increased by months, weeks, months to even years. I have dogs, I've seen them 2 years ago on CKD, they are still on CKD diet, they are on supplements, and they're okay. I would say that way. You can prolong their life by years, I would say.
Definitely. Yeah. Thank you, sir. So like someone has asked regarding like the dental tartar is one of the cause of CKD.
See, normally it is said like this, not the cause. You should say that dogs which have halitosis, then problems in the oral cavity, are the patients prone for both hepatic as well as kidney problems. So you should view them as probably they have CKD, they have a hepatic insufficiency both. So for a practitioner, if you have a patient which is not eating and you find severe halitosis, the first thing to be done is diagnose and differential diagnosis is CKD. That's what I would put it as.
Okay, sir. Thanks, sir. So one question is regarding, is there any option for renal implant in transplant in animals, sir?
Theoretically, yes. Theoretically, yes. And when I was doing, I was interested, maybe 20 years ago, I got the first dialyzer to the Veterinary College Bangalore. The machine what I showed there is the machine which I got donated 25 years ago. My passion later, you know, turned out to be something different. I became an administrator. So during that time, I used to interact with lots of people of nephrologists. And then I said, shall we think in terms of this? The whole of Europe and the Western countries talk less about kidney failure, first of all, compared to Asian region. So the research that is going on, theoretically, it is possible for a kidney transplant. But as of now, under the Indian scenario, I have not seen any research group which is working on transplant of the kidney in the Asian region.
At least in Asia.
Yeah, in Asia.
Sir, what will be the good example of phosphate binder? I think you have already answered it, sir, in the PPT.
Yeah, yeah.
So we will not go it again over there. Then another question is like, how effective is nitrilone, an anabolic steroid, effective for treating CKD, as it is said to be enhanced erythropoiesis?
Yeah, I did talk about it. See, earlier people used to talk of anabolic steroids, but anabolic steroids are not an applauded compound. Though you here and there you find some literature saying that, you know, they would help, but generally it is said they bring more catabolism, and more catabolism meaning more protein breakdown and more blood urea nitrogen and more creatinine. So that way, you know, they may not be very, very right. There can be rare cases when you use them, they become all right, but not generally. I have one interesting question here. What treatment should be given if CKD is associated with pyometra and ascites? I would say CKD is associated with pyometra. No. Pyometra is associated with CKD. This should be the other way around. I would put it that. So if you have to do that, I think for pyometra, CKD, if you have to do creatinine being elevated, what is the kind of risk of anesthesia to go for a pyometra surgery? Unless you remove the infection, the creatinine value may not come down. So I have an answer for that. Ascites, when you say ascites, it's a fluid accumulation. Abdominal fluid accumulation can occur in ascites. It could occur in hemoperitoneum. It could occur in a kidney disorder. It could also occur in congestive heart failure. So you need to make a specific way and say how to eliminate that. In such situations, diuretics and ACE inhibitors are ideal, and fluid can be eliminated by that.
Yes, sir.
And hypoalbuminemia, if it is because of hypoalbuminemia, you need to correct the hypoalbuminemia as well in such situations. Yes, please, sir.
So one question was regarding like GFR plays a very important role like in understanding the renal condition.
Yeah.
So they're asking, is any best method in the clinical setup where we can do practically to measure GFR?
GFR, the ideal parameter is the creatinine. That's what I said. Creatinine is one of the way, because creatinine, all of us know very well that creatinine is not produced in the kidney. Creatinine is an end product of the muscle metabolism, which is eliminated by the kidney. So if the creatinine levels, when it is going up, creatinine is not being eliminated. That's all it would talk of. That itself is a good test, glomerular filtration rate. Right? There are so many like vasopressin, water deprivation tests, all theoretical, but you cannot do them. In the clinical practice, you cannot do that. Another methodology is glomerular filtration, what I talked about. 20% dextrose or 25% dextrose, give intravenous. Within 1 hour, check the urine. If it is glucose positive, GFR is good. That's a good indicator. That's a good indicator.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
That's really good, sir.
Yes.
So like almost we have completed major questions, or what has been asked. Most of the questions are repeated over here right now.
Yes.
Yes. So like some
I have a concluding question to my teacher. I have a concluding question to my teacher. My question will be the final.
Yes, please.
And
yes,
so
please.
That, I will thank you, everyone. Sir.
Yes.
You mentioned that the chronic kidney disease is due to 90% non-infectious, only 10% infectious, right, sir?
Right, correct.
So this 90% contributes, what causes do you attribute, sir, in your common practice? Because you are also a great practitioner.
Yeah.
What does it contribute? What does it contribute to?
In fact, Dr. KTP, this is a very interesting question. the problem that ends up is many a time the etiological agent in these cases cannot be identified at all, or there is no way to identify because we are depending upon the creatinine or an SDMA which only says there's a kidney damage. What caused it is very difficult. Maybe we'll have to go by elimination, but in more than in this 90%, I would say in more than about 80% of the cases, the etiology cannot be identified at all. Very difficult. There may be a few cases when we talk in terms of. That's the reason why our treatment has been only supportive, and we want further kidney damage to be stopped. That's the reason why, you know, the success rate is very poor for us. That's a very interesting question. In fact, that is the reason, because in one of the slides I made a mention there, probably you could make out that you cannot identify the cause when we have an elevated creatinine value. You will just say there is a damage in the kidney, but what caused it is very difficult to identify. Overall, hardly 20% of the cases have a definite etiology, and majority do not have. And probably in the last cause in the CKD, I'd put idiopathic. That is probably the only thing that will help us, and to say that idiopathic CKD, that's what it will end up as. And if these animals are on, and probably if these animals or DJD patients or any of them are in a long-term therapy, maybe we can avoid that. And certain situations are maybe drug-induced sometimes, I would say, because owner, it is not the practitioner, I would say, they take it for granted that it is, instead of going to the doctor, why not I keep on all meloxicams or pyroxicams, whatever it is, use it for 4 weeks, 5 weeks, then come to us, then you end up in CKD. And there you can very well say it is drug-induced and you need to stop such kind of things. Maybe that's where we can identify. Okay. In other situations, very difficult. And infectious, definitely leptospira, like as I said, by BCA, et cetera, et cetera. And there, those cases are very less.
From my side.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. From my side, like regarding this, like we have normally seen a lot of emphasis given on for hyperphosphatemia management.
Yes.
In CKD.
Yeah.
So whatever this phosphate binders we use, how much it is essential and like how important it is for management of CKD patients?
For phosphatemia cases, when you talk of calcium binders, go by the phosphorus level estimation. That's number one. If the phosphorus level is higher, then use them. Otherwise, as in a routine case, you don't need it. Reason being, what it does is, it converts into calcium phosphate. All these binders, what they do, they make it as calcium phosphate and eliminate the phosphorus. In the process, it can be both ways of that. It can be hypocalcemia or hypercalcemia. Both are a possibility. So if there's an elevation in the phosphorus level, use them. Definitely they would help. They make a lot of a difference. You should go by the phosphorus quantitation. Just in every case, you may not need it.
It is not required.
It's not required. Okay. Every case is not required. We need to depend upon the biochemistry. Biochemistry is very important, and when we talk about biochemistry, I would say as a practitioner, what you need to worry about is CBC, wherein we are worried about hemoglobin, TEC, TLC rarely because leptospira what we talk about, other parameters for us being blood urea nitrogen, creatinine, sodium, potassium, calcium, phosphorus. And now if it is possible, if all these are not necessary, if we can depend on SDMA, SDMA will help for the diagnosis, but again, management will have to depend on these parameters. SDMA is for a diagnosis at an early stage. It's proven beyond doubt, irrespective of whoever is manufacturing. Let us not talk about who is doing, whether it's important or not. SDMA has been proven that it can detect the kidney damage as early as 20% damage has occurred. That means we are left with 80% of the tissue. If not, for easy reasons, I always say, creatinine one goes up when 75% is damaged. I can put it other way, SDMA is elevated when 25% is damaged. Not for book writing, at least for our convenience, we can say SDMA is definitely.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. So what I can get from the entire sir thing is like every CKD case is a unique case, and it's not a thumb rule, like all treatment will work for every patient.
Definitely.
So we have to monitor the patient according to the severity.
Very right. It's similar to see, it is CKD comes under our metabolic disease rather than calling it as an infectious disease. It is no more. That's why people talked it as, why not it was called as nephritis? No, it is not nephritis alone. It is, definition wise, what I said, a structural change as well as a functional change. It can be just a functional change, not necessarily structural damage. Yes. It can be only a functional change as well. So that's why these are all called as kidney diseases rather than calling it as itis. It is hepatitis. Okay, it's not hepatitis. Yes, it is kidney disease. It is considered that way. And in the practice, in the practice, one point which I did not generalize is great majority. Number one is dermatology. The second most common encounterance is kidney disease. I think this is pretty important for all the practitioners that more than 25 to 30% of the cases in a day-to-day practice is CKD. That means if you have a 10 patient, 20 patient, 30, 40, 50 attendants, you can go by the fact that about 25 to 30% are renal disorders,